Last week was the Young People's Day, and we had spoken to you about that story in Luke called the Prodigal Son. Even though the Bible does not address it as the story of the prodigal son, we explained that his behavior was prodigal. As a consequence, therefore, the prodigal son is not far off from the truth and the meaning of the story. That story did not end at verse 24 of Luke 15. It continues on to verse 33. And today, we will go back to Luke 15 and finish the story. The first son is called the prodigal son. And our topic today is the problem son. Jesus told a story, and it behooves us to retell it with meaning, with emphasis, and with clarity. Luke 15, verse 25, and we will go to the end of the chapter as time permits. Now his eldest son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. We pause here for now. I call your attention to the fact that here in this second part of the story, the elder son is not at home. In the beginning of the story, he was left at home while the prodigal son went wayward, or as they say today, went rogue. But this young man, he had more problems than the prodigal son. If the prodigal son bespeaks the sinner, you tell me whom the elder son bespeaks. Now, I have had, they're now dead, older brothers and sisters. So have you. Do you have stories to tell as to what you suffered or endured at the hands of your older brother and sister? The prodigal son could tell you stories about what he suffered at the hand of his brother, his older brother. But from the declarations and the behavior of the older brother, you can very well tell what kind of pressure this older brother brought to the younger brother. So it says here, when the older brother returned home, meaning he was not at home, he heard music and dancing, and that couldn't be coming from my house. He was surprised, and so he called one of his father's servants, what's going on, buddy? What's going down? The younger brother has returned, and your father is glad, and he's glad to receive him, and so he has sprung a party because he's received him safe and sound. Verse 27, and he said unto him, meaning the servant, your brother is come, and your father hath killed the fatted calf because he had received him safe and sound. Verse 28. And he was angry. What in this story so far should make this young man angry? Anger is a trait that shows itself in many a Christian. It is Paul that said in Ephesians in 4 and 26, be angry. So you can be angry, but finish the verse. But sin not. Some people get so angry they cannot speak a straight sentence without profanity. Christians should not be profane. I cannot, in my wildest imaginings, see Paul being profane. He was angry. He was angry and attitudinal because he wouldn't go in. I'm not going in there. My brother is back. I'm not going in there. Have you seen the attitude of some Christian people? You want to know if they're a part of the same organization that Christ began, the Church of God? Angry and attitudinal. You know, or attitude, more than anything else, more than our speech, declares loudly and verbosely who we really are. What is your attitude? Mr. Davis was particular in asking me to address sometime today, and I certainly will, the story of Ephraim and Manasseh. Some weeks ago, I gave a sermon and I used that passage as found in Genesis 48, the blessing of the two boys. And I hope to bring that up as much as we possibly can in some kind of a Bible study today. So this young man was so, you know the popular word, when he came back and saw and heard, because he hadn't come face to face with his brother yet since the brother had returned, when he realized that his brother had come back and the father had killed the father of God because he had received him safe and sound, he was mad. I'm not going in there. It is amazing what minute, stupid things make Christian people mad. And like the older son, attitudinal. What is your attitude toward God, brethren? What is your attitude toward God's people? Do you see yourself as God sees you? Or are you too angry to see yourself in the mirror? And some people get angry. They hang their Christianity up and say, God, forgive me, but I gotta do this. That is not the spirit of Christ. The word says about Christ, when he was reviled, he reviled not again. Is that your attitude when things don't go your way? It should be. Your attitude should be Christ-like. And because of his attitude outside the house, somehow one of the servants must have run and told his dad, listen, come outside. Your son is in a bad mood. Notice the difference in the story. When the younger prodigal came home, the father was looking for him. Where is my son? Where is my boy? And he saw in the dim distance this, should we say, emaciated character coming back, nearly dragging him. The father ran, fell on his neck, and kissed him. Other times when you're so angry, you don't even want to shake your fellow Christian's hand. That's attitudinal. But the father ran to this son who had been prodigal. He didn't say, oh, you owe me some kind of apology, boy. You got to tell me what went down. He fell on his dirty neck. Remember, he was among pigs. And kissed him. What a parental love. Brethren, that is the kind of love, though not spoken here by Christ, that God has for us. You know me now that I'm in a suit and a tie and glasses. But I have been a sinner, buddy. I have been wayward. I, like the prodigal son, have strayed far from home and father. But God, in his mercy toward me, and as the sermonette said, toward you, God is of great mercy. He received us. But it is amazing. Many times we are not as willing to receive others who come back to the fold, tattered and torn and broken and bent. Like this older son, he was mad, as he said, angry and attitudinal. So somebody ran and said, Dad, come. Your older boy is outside, he doesn't want to come in. Have you ever had to deal with a situation like that? I've had to deal with situations like that. We have to beg, as the father did. What is the word? He was angry and would not go in, verse 29. And he answering said to his father, who had already come out to him, listen to this retinue of greatness. Lord, these many years have I served you, and I have not transgressed your law. Aha! You have not transgressed God's law. You're so supreme. You're so sinless that you can refer to say, I have not broken your law. Listen to this older brother who was supposed to be the good boy, who had stayed home, who represents the Christian. He started telling God how many years he'd been serving him. You think God didn't know that? You think God knows how many years you have been serving him? But you had to bring it up. All these years I've been here in the church, never given anything to do. What an attitude. Lo, these many years do I serve you, neither transgress I at any time. Does that sound braggadocia? Does it sound sinful? I have not transgressed your law. What caused us to have salvation had it not been for all of us transgressing the law of God? Romans 3 and 23. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But that's what salvation is. Bringing us back to God out of love, out of concern, out of caring. But here is this braggadocious young man outside the palings of the house saying, I have not transgressed your law, neither have I broken your commandments. And that, as you know, is a lie. And yet, because I've been the good son, you never killed for me a fatted calf that I, the arrogance that dominates and that reeks in this good boy, is literally shameful. Yet you never gave me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. I wonder whose friends have been. Who have been your friends? Aren't we all your friends? The father in the house and the servants that serve the father, haven't they been his friends that I might make merry with my friends? Who are your friends, brethren? Are we in God's church your friends, or your best friends are outside? You can hang with them, talk like them, behave like them. You've been washed. You've been called to be a part of the family of God. But here this young man who in a way represents the Christian brother, he says, you never give me a kid. You tell God that. You never sent me a new car. You never gave me two or three houses. I see my neighbors have it. Brethren, this young man was attitudinal. And we in the church of God have got to watch our attitude. You can make a verbal plan, I'm a Christian. He also said these many years. Do you have to tell God how many years you've been serving him? I've been serving God now since I've been a teenager. What does that have to do with the price of sugar? What are you today? As you thank God for your life, are you a better Christian today than you were 2 weeks ago? As you examine your life, are you growing in understanding, or are you stuck at the same place you've been for the past 10 years? Only you can answer that. And now the older brother start bringing up bile and bitterness and starts itemizing what the father didn't know. But then you have to answer, if he knew that, did he ever go to dad and say, Dad, I heard what Johnny's doing, you know, down there in the strange land. Apparently he never did tell the father. So as the father runs out and embraces and talks to the younger wayward son, look at the words of venom in verse 30. All of a sudden, he's no longer affiliated with this boy, this wayward, no good, as they say in the Caribbean, good for nothing. In verse 30, he says, but as soon as this thy son was come, this thy son? Or is this my brother? No longer does he want to be associated with this young man. As soon as this son has come back, look what you've done for him. That is bile. That's vulgar. That is no appreciation for a fellow human being. Would to God, we in God's church would never ever speak of another human being with that disdain and distance. We are all the sons of God by creation. We more particularly by having been called of God to be in the household of faith. So he said, I don't want to be associated with him. As soon as this your son has come back. And then he begins to enumerate. Some people you only have to get a little variance of views with them or from them. And they start telling you about your mother and your father and your cousins. And look what this young man says in verse 31. But as soon as this thy son has come, which hath devoured your living with harlots. He knew this all along. And he didn't tell the father, your son was carrying on with harlots. But now he gets a chance and he throws it at him. The sad thing is some brethren of the Church of God like to be in a position where they can throw things in your face to humiliate you or to make you look bad. So what is this, your son has come, who have devoured his living with harlots. Are you anxious to tell somebody else's story? I know about you, you know. I have found out things about you, but I'm not going to tell you now. But you step on my toes and the ceiling will come in. That's exactly what this young man was doing to his brother. He's devoured your living with harlots. You know, Jesus was telling this story about the so-called prodigal son. But what does he say? He says in the story that he lived riotously. Didn't itemize what the boy did, but here this carnal young man who was at home as the good boy that I can tell you a thing or two. His son devoured his portion of the goods with harlots. Look what you've done. You've killed for him the fatted calf. The father stood there with tears running down his eyes. Couldn't believe that this young man that has been in this house for so long had this bile, this garbage piling up in him. And is now spewing it out on the brother. Oh my God, this end of the story, he hadn't seen the brother yet. He was still outside, remember? Soon it's your son has come, not my brother. You've killed for him the fatted calf. The father standing there with tears running down his eyes. Couldn't believe what he was hearing. Has that ever been your portion? You've heard some Christians speak, and you're agape. I can't believe what I'm hearing from this person. When we had the breakup of the churches, you've heard some vile bile coming out of some fellow Christian's mouth who was supposed to be going with us to the place of safety. Somebody said about the separation of the churches, there's only going to be one place of safety. And if you don't want to talk to me now, are we going to be able to get along in the place of safety? Or is it going to be a second or a third place of safety where you can go and I can't go? Standing there with tears running down his eyes, his first word was, "Son. Son." He couldn't believe his son was talking like this. And you've surely had that experience, hearing people talk who said they love God and they're a part of the work of God and they're giving offering toward the redemption of the salvation of the world. You couldn't believe what they're saying. We couldn't believe when the division and the breakup came. No wonder they had to run. Son, thou art ever with me. You hear. You see us taking care of the goats and the cows and the ducks and the chickens, and you're here with me all the time, and all that I have is yours. You think he knew that? But he had to belch out this bile and this vile and this vulgarity. All that I have is yours. You remember the story? The father had divided the goods and given to the wayward carnal son his portion to go with it. You want to go? Go. And all that was left was for the son who had remained, if not by actuality, by inheritance, when the father would have died. Verse 32. It was meet. It was necessary. It has been the right thing to do that we should be merry. Some Christian people never have merriment in their hearts and minds. They can't be happy. They always have a sad story to tell. They all can puke ignorance and nonsense and stupidity. And you want to know, is he growing in understanding? Is he getting better? It was necessary that we be glad. Brethren, we ought to be rejoicing and be glad because we have been redeemed. We are not better, but we have been redeemed. Others have not yet been redeemed because they have not claimed salvation in Jesus Christ. But we rejoice because that burden of bile. I'm always angry. I remember when wrath came up. And I heard it, I said, wow, And I said to myself, after looking at it, I said, why is it the rappers have to be so angry? Why? You can tell your story calmly, understandably, and without anger. This young man was angry. That was the first salvo thrown about him. He was angry. Rappers have to turn their hat behind it. Talk about the cops as pigs and dogs. I remember telling the story of the prodigal son some years ago, and I said, you know, he was somebody's son. And the very people you throw these invectives out and against, they are somebody's child. Above all, they are the creation of God. He said it was meat. It was necessary. Can you understand that? That we rejoice. The Bible says, rejoice with those who do rejoice. And weep with those who weep. Some of the stories coming across on television, they evoke weeping. Can you weep with that cop who lost his life yesterday in Chicago because he was gunned down? Can you be sorry for those who were burnt in that house? What is in that family today? Or do you stigmatize your anger and your rejoicing only when things please you? Remember, brethren, that God sees it all. The psalmist said, and Martin Luther said, how long, O Lord? How long? How long are you going to wait to do something? But we cannot force the hand of God. We cannot tell God, it's about time you do something now. This is a burden. I can't bear it anymore. The Psalms are filled with the word wait. I have a seminar on that. One word, wait. Wait, I say on the Lord. And he would bring it to pass. It was meet that we rejoice and be glad. For this your brother, he referred to the brother as this your son. But now the compassionate father says, this your brother. Can you call somebody a brother in good faith and in good understanding without rancor? And without getting so angry, this your brother was dead. That's what we say in Christianity. Conversion is actually coming back from the dead. The Bible says, Paul says to the Ephesians, they were dead in trespasses and in sin. Do you see yourself as being dead before coming to God? He was dead, practically. When that young man left the house with his bag of money and all of that he could carry, which of course was given to him by the father, we don't look at it like that. This your brother was dead. And the state before conversion is death. If we had died while we were in our sins, plural, knew where he would have gone. If that young man had died out there in the foreigner's pig pen, where would he have gone? He was dead and is alive. Brethren, conversion is life from the dead. We don't use the term in the Church of God, born again, but we know what it means. Coming back from the dead. We use the word conversion. We use the term called. The brother was dead. And he's alive again. He had sufficient life to crawl back. Maybe on his hands and his knees to come back to this property. And he also says,
and he was lost.
We still use the term lost. The prodigal son was lost. And do you realize that this young man, though he stayed home, he too was lost? When he came, vomit that bile on the father, he is certainly in a state of lostness. And we are in a state of lostness before we come to Christ, the Savior of mankind, and ask him to forgive us of all sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's 1 John 1:9. Your brother was dead. Your brother was lost. When you see people outside of God's church who are not converted, do you, like Jesus Christ, standing outside of Jerusalem and weeping and saying, "Oh Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you that killed the prophets and stoned those that I sent to you, how oft would I have gathered you together as a hen gathers the chicks under her wings, but you would not." Today, the land of Israel is under attack. It's living in the midst of foes that are willing to gouge their hearts out and their eyes out, because the other three, that was all land. Ishmael was the firstborn. They cannot understand, how on earth could you give all the blessings to the second son, Isaac, when Ishmael was the firstborn? And so they're driving force is to repossess that land of Israel. Talk about some of those things in the Bible study. Get it back. But have they stopped to think it's only land? It's only ground. It's only earth. And Psalm 24 begins by saying the earth is the Lord's. So after we fought for it and gotten it, have you ever really fought for something? You got it. I got that car that I wanted. When it's driven off of the lot from the showroom, it is already a used vehicle. He knew somebody who got a new car, and she was advised, "You're not in a position to afford this car. You better take it back." And she attempted to do so within days of having had it. And they said, "We don't take back cars, we sell cars." Your brother was lost. If we get a picture of how God sees things, it should shape the way we think. If we understand the lostness of man, it's like a pig with the pink bow tied around it, all washed and cleaned, and it slips away from you, and it goes running back to the swamp. Goes running back to environs that are its habitation. That's where it lives. That's where it stays in its normal life. Your brother was lost and is found. Two different states. Black and white. No gray. You're either lost or you're found. Have you been found by God? Have you been redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ? Or are you just making a profession? While underneath is vile, transformed, brethren. That's what Jesus Christ died for, to bring you out of that lifestyle, to bring you out of that pig pen, to bring you out of that quagmire. You have been redeemed. Lived as though you are. It reminds me of a story I heard of a guy who, in the days when everybody going anywhere was sailing by boat, ship, and he was going for the first time. So he packed his bag with sardines and mackerel, and he would sneak out. He didn't know how thorough and complete his ticket was and what it afforded him. He would sneak out and eat his sardine and his mackerel. And somebody saw him one day and said, "What are you doing? Your ticket entitles you to eat at the table and enjoy the food that the ship provides." Really? If you've gone to a feast where everything is under one roof, you know that when you get to that hotel, they put a band on your hand, red band, meaning you're in the upper class, you have some of the better rooms in the hotel, or green band, or whatever it might be, and it entitles you to all the food that's served in the hotel. You get so accustomed to the place, and so at home, that they don't even ask, "Okay, I see your band." They know if you're here and you're a part of the people being housed here, you're entitled. My wife and I were in Jamaica, no, Bahamas, some years ago. And we were having a great time. Actually, we went for a honeymoon tour, but this was a separate visit. I think it was a visit to remind us. And we were there, like everybody else, on the beach, having fun and having a ball. And those who were inhabitants of the hotel, you could get outside on the beach. Food, again, hot dogs and all sorts of things. Because you are a part, it's all covered in the price. But while we were there, there were some ladies who had come onto the grounds selling different things to the occupants of the hotel. I think they came somewhere along the seashore from one property to the next. And we were talking and they were telling us what they have to sell and everything. We were listening to this story. And then the lady said to us, "Listen, can you give me a hot dog and a burger?" They were not entitled to receive it. They wanted to sell their wares, but they did not have a right to go to the bar and get a drink, or go to the stand and order a hot dog. But we, who were there as guests in the hotel, we could do it. My wife and I did go down to the stall, saw their plight, and got them a hotel. I got them a hot dog. It was right. They couldn't afford it, nor the people in the stand would give it to them because they didn't have the band on their hand. They were not entitled. But we who were residents there for that period of time could buy it, and either furtively or clandestinely see to it that they got the hotel, they got the hot dog, or they got the burger, whatever it was that was given. Brethren, we are entitled. By virtue of Christ dying for us, we get everything that's being served. But we are so stupid. "I don't need that. I don't want that." God never expected to take away freedom of choice from us. He said, "I don't want that. I don't want that. I don't eat that." So, the story ends with the father begging the son to come in. "Come and fellowship with us." Drop that bad attitude. Throw away that bile, that vulgarity that's building up within you. And accept the people that God has called to his kingdom, who are now resident here on earth, but who are bound for the promised land to share with Jesus Christ, the Son of God, all that salvation entails. It is for us to enjoy your salvation, brethren. It is for us who have stayed at home not to be worse than the prodigal son by being a problem son or daughter, but to enjoy the things that God has prepared for us. And Paul says, you think these times are good? I have not seen, nor ear heard, the wondrous, glorious things that God has prepared for them that love him and fear him. Brethren, we haven't seen anything yet. God has wondrous things out there for us. He's prepared a place for us. We will enjoy them. If we get there, we wouldn't get there with a carnal mind. We wouldn't get there by harboring in our hearts and in our minds and in our consciences and in our souls bitterness. Paul said to the Hebrews, let all bitterness be put away. It is for us to live the life that God wants us to live. Because, as the Father said to the Son, Son, all that I have is yours. Jesus Christ and God the Father want us to inherit all things, because that's a part of the package of God's salvation into which he has brought you, to make you a son or a daughter of his. In Revelation chapter 5, we read that we will be kings and priests with God the Father and Jesus Christ the Son. Brethren, we are sons of God. Let us live as though we are sons, and not live as though we are foreigners.